morning, Your Honors. May it please the Court, my name is Sarah Sylvia Taylor for the petitioner, and I would like to reserve 2 minutes of my time for rebuttal. The key issue in this case is whether there was substantial evidence in the record to support a finding of implausibility. The stakes here are high. Will we permit the Board to use the mere fact of return trips to dismiss the value of all the evidence the petitioner submitted? No, we should not. The evidence in the record compels reversal in this case, because Real ID does not permit the Board to cherry-pick facts that support an adverse credibility finding and disregard facts that contradict that finding. Under the totality of the circumstances in this case, any reasonable fact finder would conclude that the petitioner gave plausible explanations for her returns. The Board's decision is based solely on the fact that the petitioner made 2 return trips to Nepal. The Board provided no other basis to support the adverse credibility finding. Rather, the Board decided that the petitioner was not wise for returning to Nepal, and on that basis alone, decided she was not credible.
How do you distinguish Loho versus Mukasey from 2008? It seems like it's the exact same case to me.
Loho does not control in this case because the purpose of her previous return trips was never to flee, and her fear is based on events that happened after her last return. She went to Japan in October 2006 for business. She went to the United States in November 2008 to visit her brother. Loho returned after she fled for the safety of the United States, and despite testifying that she was actually afraid, yet she took minimal steps to look into asylum. Unlike in Loho,
the client here, your client, Ms. Sharma, never fled or took any study. As I see it, in 03, 04, 05, and 06, according to her testimony, and prior to going to Japan, the Maoists engaged in very serious threats, including saying that they would kill her. Threatened death after detonating a bomb in the Chimiva Hotel. Apparently, she met with the king of Nepal, who advised that if Ms. Sharma didn't join his party, they'd kill her. 2006, dozens of Maoists demanded that she pay them money. She refused. In light of all that, she went to Japan, voluntarily returned, left the country later, and voluntarily returned. None of these things keep in place.
Well, by claiming that the petitioner suffered more serious harm before her returns, the Board unreasonably ignored compelling evidence.
That's not my question. My question is the evidence that I just stated.
We disagree because what happened after her last return was more serious and more life-threatening than what happened previously. For the first time, they came to her home, and for the first time, they attempted to kidnap her. And so the question here isn't what's reasonable or wise, according to the Board. The question is what is plausible.
How are those threats more serious than the physical attacks you suffered previously?
Because this time, the threats, when the Maoists came to her house on August 6, 2009, they threatened to kidnap her and gave her a strict 7-day deadline to comply with their demands. And then 6 days later, on August 12, 2009, they came, 10 to 12 of them appeared in a mini truck and attempted to kidnap her, and she happened not to be home. This was different because previously she was assaulted, but they did not threaten future harm, and so...
If that's true, why didn't she immediately apply for asylum when she arrived here in the United States?
What she's contending is that the cumulative...
If that's true, why didn't she immediately apply? Why did she wait 5 months?
Because she was fearful, but... She did not reach the point where she was fearful for her life and safety until after fleeing, her husband reported to her that the Maoists continued to come for her at home and at work, and that it would not be possible to return.
That makes this case for Attorney General Lynch stronger than Low Hope, then, doesn't it?
No, because the book. No, because Loho had decided to flee, and when she returned despite her fear. And here the petitioner has never returned after she reached the point where she had a well-founded fear of return. Here, the severity of harm is based on a continuum of repeated incidents of persecution over time, with increased frequency and intensity. All incidents taken together result in a greater fear than ever before, but the board ignored all of this. Her explanation that she thought the Maoists might have forgotten about her was plausible in light of the circumstances. At that time, the last issue she had with the Maoists was when she learned that they came to her workplace in mid-November 2008, after she had arrived in the U.S. Then 5 months passed without incident. When she came the last time to the United States, although she hoped to return, and she said that she was hoping to return, when her husband told her that the Maoists continued to appear at her home and her work, then she realized, unlike before, that she would not be able to return and expect safety in the United States.
Do you want to reserve the rest of your time, if I may?
Yes, Your Honor. Thank you.
Good point to stop right there.
Good morning. May it please the Court, this is Dana Camilleri for the Attorney General. It's our position that under this court's decision, Loho v. Mukasey, the board properly determined that Sharma's two voluntary returns to Nepal, coupled with the fact that she did not so much as investigate the possibility of asylum during her lengthy trips to Japan.
Our time is short. Let's talk about Ding versus Ashcroft. The Ninth Circuit, quote, overturned an adverse credibility determination based on a voluntary return to the country of persecution, when the IJ improperly ignored parts of the petitioner's testimony, explaining that she was coerced into returning to her home country, close quote. That's what happened here, right? She was...
Where is the coercion to force her to return, is my confusion.
Well, she has to go back to work. She has to go back to her family. She has to go back to her school.
But... Like the alien in Loho, she's going back to her family and community, and this court already found that wasn't sufficient to render it plausible that she would put herself in harm's way.
What's the main distinction between Ding? It doesn't seem that there's a finding other than that the woman voluntarily, by the IJ, I should say, she voluntarily returned to her home country. Beyond that, we don't really have any evidence of.
Your Honor, honestly, I'm not familiar with Ding. I am familiar with other cases distinguishing Loho, in which the petitioner, for example, was his wife and she had pregnancy complications. That was Moglu, I believe. And he was coerced to return because of threats to her safety. But here, Sharma admitted that there had been no threats to her husband.
Are you familiar with Boer Sedanio 418 F3rd 1082?
Yes, I am.
What's the distinction between that case and
Well, that case is related to the presumption of a well-founded fear versus the credibility aspect. So it's not contradictory to Loho in any way.
Boer Sedanio does talk about return trips and whether return trips alone can rebut the presumption, doesn't it?
It does, but I believe in all those cases there were other considerations versus returning to a business or returning to a community. that would show why this person is willing to put themselves in harm's way.
So it looks like we're very focused on her level of fear, right?
Yes.
Okay. And whether or not it was sufficient, it seems like. So I'm trying to figure out what do we do, what do we make of this extensive documentary evidence, because the time that I've been on this court and looking at these cases, this case is rather unique. The extensive evidence in the record seems to greatly corroborate Ms. Sharma's testimony that she suffered past persecution. If I'm looking here correctly, she provided statements from coworkers, family, friends, the police, and the mosque that attested to specific incidents when Ms. Sharma was attacked or threatened. She also provided detailed country reports and a psychological evaluation diagnosing her with PTSD because of the persecution she endured. Entirely apart from Ms. Sharma's testimony, I'm just trying to figure out, isn't that enough to establish past persecution?
Well, I believe one of the significant factors here for the agency, and it was touched on with Petitioner's counsel, was the fact that a lot of the violent and very serious, in 2005 she said she thought that they were going to kill her and rip her tongue out, and she was close to death, but she continues, she travels to Japan, she returns, she spends 5 months in the United States, she returns, she then comes to the United States again, supposedly fleeing, but she waits until 2 days before her visa runs out to pursue asylum.
But it had been, there's been this whole back and forth with the Maoists, and the interaction with the Maoists, and she, I just wonder, if she had left on the first instance, I think that the government would have challenged whether or not she'd been fearful enough, and so it's an interesting balance, I guess, that we have to look at. When is the exact point, that she is fearful enough, but not too soon, and hopefully not, for her sake, too late. So I'm just curious here what the circumstances have been developed in the record. It looks like she was interacting with the Maoists, but it didn't cause her fear to be so great. And then it got to the point that she really was that fearful. It seems like the last incident probably may have supported that. It doesn't look like the IJ discredited any of the documentary evidence in the record that supports all of her fear testimony. Does it? Is that correct?
Right. I don't think the evidence was discredited more so that they weren't persuaded that it rendered her testimony plausible. It wasn't sufficient enough to overcome the implausibility of these return trips, the lengthy stays, especially because she did say the second time she was in the United States, she was aware that they were going to her businesses.
So what is there in the record to suggest the implausibility of Ms. Sharma's testimony that she only felt compelled to leave Nepal after the Maoists came to her home for the first time?
Well, I think as the immigration judge and the board stated, this idea that the threats were ramping up in their severity is kind of belied by the record, because the two physical attacks occurred, the one in 2005 and I believe the other one in 2008 before her first trip to the United States, and there were no physical altercations after that, and she knew that they were looking for her. Her husband was communicating that while she was in the United States the first time. So I guess the question is coming down to this from her neighbor, that they came looking for her again. But the demands were sort of the same. They still wanted money from her.
But they'd come to her home for the first time.
Right. That's true.
Is there anything in the record that shows that Sharma claimed to be subjectively afraid of returning to Nepal during the previous trips?
No, and that also undermines her claim in its own way.
How so?
Because I think despite this list of incidents that she supposedly suffered, she had no pause to return.
Well, but it seems like what's being played out here is that despite what was happening, she was able to handle it. She was going forward. She had a good job. She was working at this hotel, I believe, wasn't it? Which is a very unique thing. I mean, I think to have, for a woman, in her circumstance, to have that kind of position. And she was going forward with her life. And she was, despite these attacks, which she felt were percolating and increasing, she was going forward. And I'm just trying to figure out, do we not factor that in, that it seems entirely plausible here that she kept her job, she kept going back, despite the fact that the mouse were getting more and more threatening, but then didn't leave until it reached the level. And I know some people will offer that as an explanation why they didn't come sooner, but here, the documentary evidence, everything else that she's brought in, seems rather significant in terms of the detail and the amount and the fact that it was not really contested. So that's the quandary I'm in and trying to figure out. And it just seems like this case may be different, but I want you to give me your best shot as to why not.
Well, I guess I will bring in the standard of review. Reasonable minds can disagree, but that's not enough to compel another result. I think that the board here and the agency really looked at all this evidence and just could not understand why, after the physical attacks, which were supposedly severe, she didn't even consider not returning. That is implausible to be here for 5 months. And then, in addition to
that, if she had come at that point, whether you would be saying that that wasn't enough.
I can't speculate. I can't speculate what the board would do under those circumstances.
Argued that Loho was in Edison at different moments fast, and you should have an opportunity to respond to that.
I disagree, and I actually was going to make the points that you made, that in Loho there were actually fewer instances, fewer reasons she came to the U.S. and actually sought asylum and looked into it.
I said there was some fleeing distinction that I didn't quite pick up on. What's your response to that?
I believe the alien in Loho, I don't want to misspeak, but I believe that at one point she did flee to the U.S. and look into asylum, but her relative couldn't help her with that, and so she gave up and went back, and that was considered a problem. And here we have just very lengthy stays in the United States, 5 months each time, and no real motivation to look for asylum. Her husband supposedly, you know, is telling her that they're still coming around, even on the second trip to the United States. She waits 2 days before her visa. I think that's just really difficult for the board to feel that there's this compelling and immediate threat to her safety.
But you say that they were serious threats.
The most serious of the threats looked to have been before she even went to Japan and before the first trip. If what she's saying is true, you know, 2008, she's mugged and attacked. She comes to the U.S. for 5 months. She returns.
Well, we're assuming it's true, right, at this point. There was no adverse credibility determination.
This is an adverse credibility
determination. Yeah, that's right. But the documentary evidence seems to corroborate that, doesn't it?
I feel in this case just the implausibility of the story has cast doubt onto a lot of this, but even if we assume what she's saying is true, it just doesn't fit.
And I understand that. I mean, this seems to be a very interesting, challenging case, but it just seems at some point, some people have a higher tipping point than others. Is it not possible that her tipping point in terms of suffering the fear and trying to go forward in light of what the circumstances that she had in terms of her ability to have an income and to work and to have the position that she had, that her tipping point regarding her fear could have come at the date that she's talking about?
It might be possible, but then that circles us back to Loho saying that returning to a job was not sufficient to render it plausible that you would go back into harm's way in that manner.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
here is what was it possible for the petitioner to return when she did. She explained she had some fear when she returned previously, but it wasn't enough to flee permanently. Loho decided to flee, but then did not look into it because she didn't have enough vacation days. That is not plausible. Here, the petitioner provided plausible explanations, and the board trivialized her life in Nepal. Her explanations that she wanted to return to her community and way of life was plausible in light of the circumstances. Asylum is an extreme remedy, requiring one to abandon everything, their home, family, community, and country. It's not reasonable to conclude that anyone who's experienced threats and assaults would immediately jump to the decision to flee their native land. As the court noted, different people have different thresholds for when they reach that point of fleeing, and U.S. asylum law does not require one to seek asylum. If their claim is weak, they can wait until it's stronger. The record plainly demonstrates that she did not apply for asylum until she felt that it was absolutely necessary to save her life, and that is a well-founded fear. Ultimately, the evidence in the record compels reversal under Real ID because the board ignored relevant evidence contradicting implausibility. Again, I want to reiterate that the stakes here are high. Will the court permit the board to use the mere fact of return trips to dismiss the value of all the evidence the petitioner submitted? The court should not. The severity of harm here is based on a continuum of repeated incidents of persecution over time. All of these incidents, when taken together, result in a greater fear with increased frequency and intensity. The court should remand this case to the board because, ultimately, all of the evidence that the petitioner submitted was ignored by the board purely because she made two return trips prior to her decision to flee her country permanently. And for that reason, Loho does not apply, and the court must allow the petitioner to present her claim of asylum properly before the board.
Thank you.
Right, thank you.
Thank you both very much for your helpful arguments here this morning. We appreciate it. This case is now submitted.